Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an investigative independent journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Laura, Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com. Also, follow me on social media on X, formerly Twitter, at Annie M. Dance, where I break the latest news. Today, Tuesday, April 16th, the North Carolina General Assembly is about to host a very important meeting to discuss the 250th anniversary birthday, really, of our country with a special committee. Let's see what they have to say. This is my new special segment today at the NCGA.
I'd like to call this meeting of the America Sesquicentennial Committee to order on April the 16th in the year of our Lord 2024. Before we go into some further introductions, let me just thank. Before we go into some further introductions, let me just thank our Sergeant at Arms. Who are here today. We have both House Sergeant Arms and Senate Sergeant Arms, and the House Sergeant Arms are, if you'll raise your hand, Teresa Ferguson and then Thomas Terry. And then for the Senate, we have John Enlow, Takella Cogdell, and Dwight Green, and Hal Roach. Thank you all for your service to our General Assembly. I also want to recognize the co-chairman of this committee, Representative Hugh Blackwell, who is here with us today, and thank our staff for all the help that they have put in already and will continue to put into this committee. I want to take a little bit of time before we start with the programs today. Since this is the inaugural meeting of this committee, I thought it would be really good for us, for those members of the committee, to be able to introduce themselves very briefly and just tell a little bit about quickly who you are and kind of your background and so forth. I'm going to read the names of the committee, and then I'm going to go around and ask each one if for them to do that. And by the way, I think we will have time between the third presentation, and before we have any committee discussion, I will allow for some public comment. If there's anybody out there that would like to say anything that that we need to know about, we'll take that. We'll have 2 minutes. All right. So let me just read the members and raise your hand, and then we'll come back and then do the introductions. But Dr. Troy Kickler, Kyle Lupke, Jason Luker, the Honorable Charles Neely, and Dr. Kerry Poole. Okay, so those are the members. So why don't we just start in this way, and with you, Dr. Poole, and if you'll just if you'll push the green button and move the thing to your face there, you can.
I'm Kerry Poole. I live in Kings Mountain, and I've worked with college students for about 40 years. I just got out a couple years ago when COVID was introduced to campus, but. Just telling Jason that I have my first degree was in archaeology, so I've had a lifelong interest in history and preservation. I do have some books that address the railroad development in North Carolina, and I think that's what caught Speaker Moore's attention. But I'm glad to be here.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, and then we'll go with Mr. Luker.
My name is Jason Luker. I work for the Charlotte Museum of History. I'm from the great metropolis of Lowell, North Carolina. Been in the history field for the past 20 years, been interpreting the Piedmont area for the past 17, ranging from my first job being at Fort Defiance with William and Nora's home to the current home of Hezekiah Alexander, the oldest house in Mecklenburg County.
All right, thank you. And Dr. Kickler.
Hello, my name is Dr. Troy Kickler. I'm a senior fellow at the John Locke Foundation. I've been studying North Carolina history since grad school. At the risk of dating myself, that would be since the year 2000. So almost 25 years I've been studying North Carolina history in some capacity, and among other publications that I've published. And what makes it exciting for me to be on this committee is one of them is called The King's Troublemakers. It's about how Edenton, North Carolina played a role in the creation of the United States of America. And the second book that I will mention right now was published by UNC Press in 2019, and that's North Carolina's Revolutionary Founders. So thank you, and I'm glad to be on this committee.
Thank you, Dr. Kickler. And Dr. Kickler will be one of our presenters today. All right, then that takes us to Mr. Lupke.
Kyle Lupke. I'm from Charlotte. I'm a lawyer at McGuire Woods, unrelated to Paul Lupke. And I am not a historian. You don't want lawyers to be historians, probably. But I love North Carolina. I love the city of Charlotte. And my family goes back here generations. So very happy good. To be here.
Thank you. Representative McNeely, or Neely.
Troy, I don't understand why you're worried about dating yourself. Oh. I'm Chuck Neely. I live in Raleigh. I practiced law here for 50 years. Served in the General Assembly during the late 90s. Honored to be on the committee and working with you, Mr. Chairman, and you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. And I thought I would give just a few words, a little bit about our committee and the way that Representative Blackwell and I think we understand the what we're doing. But I thought I would just give a little bit of an update about that. This committee, the members and so forth appointed, was designated by the General Assembly to take the lead in North Carolina's commemoration and celebration of our nation's semiquincentennial observance. And if you have trouble saying that, just say 250th anniversary. And some of y'all, some, may remember the time of our nation's bicentennial back in 1976. And at that time, we had an overwhelming outpouring of, you know, pride in our heritage, renewal and resurgence in all things history, particularly relating to the Revolutionary War and, of course, the formation and foundation of our country in 1776 and the Declaration of Independence, which is basically our birth certificate, if you will. And if those of you who are around, I won't ask for you to raise your hands, but you will remember at that time, the bicentennial consumed the United States for several years, and it portrayed itself in a number of ways, all the way things from like carpeting and wallpaper, if you remember, and dinnerware, and even songs and clothing, all sorts of things, all a part of kind of colonial. It was all related to the colonial era and all that kind of stuff. And it was all part of the celebration. You had fireworks, you had concerts, you had patriotic shows, you had church picnics where people dressed up in, you know, the Revolutionary garb. And everyone, of course, at that time, you know, they spoke with pride and of what we all hold dear for our shared American experience and the freedoms that we enjoy. And then some of you may also remember in 1984 when North Carolina celebrated its 400th anniversary of its, I guess, discovery or founding. And if you recall then, it was marked by somewhat similar kinds of things. There were books that were commissioned. Charles Corral and Lunis McGlowan were commissioned to write a song and did a video about North Carolina is my home. Do any of y'all remember that? And then also there were commercials. I love calling North Carolina home and this kind of thing. It was all kind of part of that 400th anniversary celebration for North Carolina and for our love again and pride of our old North State. And I think it's the hope of Representative Blackwell and myself, and I'm sure of the committee along with others, that we want to prepare ourselves properly for the important role, to celebrate the important role that our state has played in the formation of our country. And also to give opportunities for our citizens to express their ideas, their patriotism, their pride, and to cultivate even ultimately, I think, even more historical research, preservation of important sites and properties, trails perhaps associated with the formation of our country, and also to produce hopefully some long-lasting markers for the future so that people who come after us will know what we did here. Of course, we as a committee are seeking ideas and recommendations. And if we have not already, we are going to set up a portal. Do we know if that's up yet? We will have a portal at some point in time where the public, is it set up now? I don't know how to access it, so I can't tell you that because I'm not very savvy on those things, but there is a portal. And you can go online and you can suggest ideas, give us, you know, thoughts. Keep them brief. Don't write chapters, just write small paragraphs. But let us know, you know, what you're thinking. And all of that we will be able to mix in and blend together and kind of see what we come up with. Because we want to look for ways that we can create, you know, new celebratory venues. And then also we'll be looking at how we can value add to those things that are probably already out there that we can use to further celebrate our 250th birthday. We may go back and hearken to some of those things that were done years ago and kind of maybe re-bring those up. And we may, and of course, we probably will come up with some new things that we thought of as well. And I know that both Representative Blackwell and I, I'm certain, and the committee members will share our optimism of the future of our country, largely because of the goodly heritage that we have had under the formation of our 13 individual colonies under, at that time, the rule of a distant king into one constitutional republic under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So that's my speech, and that's my opening words of to the committee. I thought I would also allow Representative Blackwell, if you have anything you would like to say at this point in time, you may, or if you want to hold off until later on, that's perfectly well as good as well.
Probably shouldn't pass up the opportunity to speak. I'm glad to see Dean Zietman back there from the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources. Deans and I have in common that we both graduated from the same high school in Halifax County, which is home to the Halifax Resolves, which I assume is probably known to most of you and is memorialized as one of the two dates on the North Carolina flag. I won't mention the other date. I'll let you do that. And I do remember back in the bicentennial days, one of my memories, rather minor actually, is my dad growing a beard for the bicentennial celebration there in Halifax County. And it was, I would say, standard back then, as it seems to be today, maybe for other reasons, that I think all three of my sons have beards now, but that was before they started celebrating the Semiquincentennial. I'm just glad that Burke County is home to the organizing point for the Overmountain Victory Men so that I can sort of somewhat hang in the same category with Senator Alexander and Dr. Poole, because, you know, they went down to Kings Mountain from Burke County after they gathered and beat up on the British. Sorry, Dr. Taylor. Yeah. anyway, I'm excited to be here, glad to have this opportunity. One final thing on the portal, I'm assuming that we've got a committee website that someone could go to and that there would be directions there on how to do that. And maybe staff can comment on that.
Henry, go ahead.
It will be by the end of the meeting.
That's great work, Henry.
Thank you, Chairman Blackwell. And I guess that's our first recommendation. I guess that we're all going to grow beards, I guess. So. All right. So, but thank you for that. And we have a really good lineup of three good speakers today. This is sort of to kind of get us going, to get us thinking along the lines of our committee and its purpose. And to begin to, we want to use our committee meetings, and Representative Blackwell and I have talked about this. We want to also, in the future, when we have committee meetings, to use those in somehow as a part of the celebration. So we're going to try to figure out how we can do that. I'm not sure exactly yet, but we do feel like that, you know, when we convene together, that that's part of the celebration, and we'll try to make it something, you know, a part of it. Let's see. Did I say that after we have three speakers, I'll introduce them, and then they can introduce themselves. And then after the speakers, I'm going to allow for public comment for 2 minutes each. If there's somebody in the audience that would like to speak up and say anything they wish to give us ideas or whatever, I'm certainly we're open to that. And then we're going to have perhaps a brief discussion, and then we'll talk about other things after that. But we have three really good presentations today. I'm really thrilled, and I'm looking forward to each one of them. I'm just going to go ahead and introduce them in order, and then we'll start each individual one. And I think, is the AV ready for the first one? Who do I?
Yes, sir, it's on.
Perfect. Okay. All right. Our first presentation is called North Carolina and the American Founding, by Professor Andrew J. Taylor, who's the director of the Free and Open Societies Project at North Carolina State University. And I'm going to allow him to say other words of introduction to himself, and then make his presentation. So thank you, Dr. Taylor. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Representative Blackwell, as well, for your service. This is a very important time and a very important committee, and I'm honored to be able to present to you today. Thank you, committee members, as well, particularly Dr. Kickler, who invited me today, so I'm very appreciative. Representative Blackwell sort of teased some of my remarks at there. But we'll get into those in a second. As Senator Alexander said, I'm Professor of Political Science, Director of Free and Open Societies Project at NC State, where I've been a professor for now nearly 29 years. I came to North Carolina in 1995. Representative Blackwell, of course, hinted at my heritage. I'm going to take some beatings today. Originally from the United Kingdom, very proud U.S. citizen. Interestingly enough, as of the day of the London bombings on July 7th, 2005. I teach courses in American politics. I come at this not so much as a historian, but more as a political scientist and someone who's interested in political philosophy and the ideas of the revolution as much as I am the events of the revolution. So as Senator Alexander said, I've tried to tie this in with North Carolina as well, but I'm going to talk broadly about the American founding as well as North Carolina's role in it. And of course, as Representative Blackwell said, the state's very important role in the drive towards independence in the middle part of the 1770s. And we think about that mainly through two actions that are commemorated on our state flag in dates on the left-hand side, the first being the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence or Mecklenburg Resolves. There's some debate about what the Mecklenburg Declaration really is, and I'll talk a little bit about that. Again, I'm not an authority on that specifically, but I'll talk a little bit about that. And then the Halifax Resolves, which were April 12th, 1776. The Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence is claimed, as many of you know, as the first Declaration of Independence in the colonies. It was declared by a committee of citizen militia from Mecklenburg County, who apparently did so upon hearing the news about the Battle of Lexington. Now, it's not really clear what they did, or fully clear to us what they did. There are dueling interpretations of it. The first is that it is the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence. It was a document formally published in 1819, which is consistent with this, had a series of statements made by the militiamen, including those that I've got up there, resolved that we, the citizens of Mecklenburg County, do hereby dissolve the political bands which have connected us to the mother country and hereby absolve ourselves from all allegiance to the British Crown, and resolve that we do hereby declare ourselves a free and independent people, are and of right ought to be a sovereign self-governing association under the control of no power other than that of our God and the general government of the Congress. That does sound like a forceful declaration of independence. However, it's sort of disputed as to what it really was. So In 1838, there was another document found that was written and ratified by, presumably by that same group of individuals, didn't have a formal affirmative Declaration of Independence in it. It sort of complained about the British a lot, more of a sense that we will declare independence unless things improve. That any kind of splitting up, any kind of formal distancing from the British Crown was not irrevocable. And this document was called the Mecklenburg Resolves rather than Mecklenburg of Declaration of Independence. And as I said, it was found in 1838. And many people, and I'm an authority on this, as I said, but there is some dispute as to which is the right interpretation. By the way, the Resolves were, so the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence date is May 31st. I think it's May 31st or May 30th. The Resolves were produced a few days earlier. And so there's a dispute about which came first and whether which one really exists. They were printed in a South Carolina newspaper, apparently, in 1838. One of the arguments for the resolve interpretation rather than the sort of more forceful Declaration of Independence interpretation, it comes from Thomas Jefferson himself, because a lot of scholars claim that the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence was sort of copied from... Jefferson kind of copied the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence, of course, in the American Declaration of Independence. And Jefferson claimed never to have heard of it. And this is sort of used as evidence of the fact that the more innocuous document is perhaps, or a more innocuous interpretation of the document is perhaps more accurate. And then, of course, there are the Halifax Resolves, which come in April of 1776. These were adopted by the Provincial Congress of North Carolina, the fourth one, in Halifax. That's why they're called the Halifax Resolves. They were visiting, they were meeting there, and this is a unanimous call for independence. And it basically instructs the North Carolina delegates to the Continental Congress to vote for a motion or a declaration of independence. Unfortunately for North Carolina, it was the state of Virginia, or delegation from the state of Virginia, that actually moved to the motion to declare independence for the Continental Congress. It was proposed by Virginia, but we were the first state to recommend that our delegates to the Continental Congress vote in favor of independence, and that's what the Halifax Resolves are. Now, most of us, even somewhat amateur historians, understand how independence was sort of gained. It was initially, of course, a political action. There were a series of violent conflicts in Massachusetts, including, of course, the famous Boston Massacre, the battles of Lexington and Concord, the Battle of Bunker Hill. There was very forceful responses to British policy in the colonies, particularly regarding matters of taxation and the expression of political rights in form of assembly and speech, matters like the Stamp Act, Sugar Act, the Intolerable Acts. Independence was formally declared, actually, on July the 2nd, 1776, really when the Continental Congress voted in favor of the Declaration of Independence, and to adopt the Lee Resolution. But, of course, we commemorate it on July the 4th, because that is when the Committee of Fives document, authored really by Thomas Jefferson, is adopted by the Continental Congress. And signed by three North Carolinians who really are sort of lost. I'll talk about some other North Carolinians later in the presentation. We don't really think about the three North Carolinians who signed the Declaration of Independence very much, I don't think. Joseph Hughes, John Penn, and William Hooper. I had to even look back up there to remind myself. And then, of course, politically, the British recognized American independence with the Treaty of Paris. Of course, in order to have it actually take effect. It was realized militarily with a military operation with a full blown war, largely, as we all know, in two campaigns, the northern and southern one. The southern one, of course, is much more interesting to us as North Carolinians. Nathanael Greene and Cornwallis, Cornwallis chases Nathanael Greene through North Carolina and through the Carolinas generally, and there's a number of skirmishes and full-blown battles that I talk about later on, mainly in South Carolina, unfortunately for us, as we want to commemorate this, but including... the Kings Mountain Cowpens battle is very important to the war effort, but really they take place in South Carolina, and the national battlefields that commemorate them are in South Carolina. But there's the Battle of Guilford Courthouse, which is important as well, which of course is solidly in North Carolina. But I think, one of the reasons, or perhaps the principal reason why Dr. Kickler asked me to come and talk a little bit about the revolution is to think about the revolution as an intellectual concept, as a series of ideas coming together, as much as expression of politics and expression of the effect of a war against the British. And so I'm going to talk about three sort of types of ideas that political philosophers, historians, political scientists see as being influential to the founding. And I'll sort of pick them apart a little bit and explain them a little bit. And as I've got them up there as Lockean liberalism, the importance of institutions, and a virtuous citizenry. So let's start with Lockean liberalism as a significant feature of the ideas that influenced the founding period. So the Locke is John Locke, who North Carolinians should be very familiar with. Locke was kind of a polymath. He was a sort of, an early British Benjamin Franklin in some ways. He was hired as an assistant to a guy called Lord Shaftesbury, Ashley Cooper, Lord Shaftesbury. He's got two rivers named after him in Charleston. Who was made secretary of the proprietors of the Carolinas, which was basically the governing board for the colony of the Carolinas. And Locke came to Shaftesbury's attention because Locke was treating him for, I can't remember what the medical ailment was, but it was a medical ailment. And Shaftesbury was so impressed by Locke, and we don't think of Locke as a physician or a doctor, but this was one of his talents. And Locke went on to author, as Shaftesbury's sort of assistant or right-hand man, the Fundamental Constitutions of Carolina in 1669, which is actually, interestingly, of all the things that Locke produced, considered one of his more conservative or aristocratic documents, which may have, it's hard to explain why, maybe because of certain situation, political conditions or pressures he was under. But that's where we know him really in the North Carolina context, because of that role. But Locke is a giant in British history. He authored the English Bill of Rights in 1689, which comes right on the heels of the Glorious Revolution of 1688, which is the establishment of ascension of William and Mary, William of Orange, of course, basically seals a Protestant ascendancy in Britain. And much of Locke's work in the English Bill of Rights is echoed in our founding documents, including our Bill of Rights, such as the right to petition, freedom of speech, that elections to Parliament should be free. There were tremendous concerns about a standing army, which of course was a very important matter to our founders. There's a sort of reference to the Second Amendment, although Locke only believes Protestants should have the power to keep and bear arms in the English Bill of Rights. And that has to do with the context, of course, of the Glorious Revolution. And even excessive bail ought not to be required, nor excessive fines imposed, nor cruel and unusual punishments inflicted. That's plagiarized completely from the English Bill of Rights, of course, and put into our Eighth Amendment. So Locke, and it would be fair, we should also say, other Enlightenment era thinkers, and Locke is a little bit on the front end of what is conventionally considered the Enlightenment period, sort of contributed these basic ideas, these basically what we call liberal ideas, or we might call classically liberal ideas, to the American founding. This idea of social equality, that, of course, the wording in the Declaration, our Declaration of Independence, that all men be created equal, or that all men are created equal, was found, expressed, of course, in Thomas Paine's Common Sense, which was an absolute sensation during the Revolutionary period, sold 250,000 copies. I mean, that, you know, that's sort of Taylor Swift numbers. In the context of the 1770s, very, very influential. And of course, our Constitution's prohibition on titles to nobility was very important to the founders, and an explicit rejection of the social inequality and hierarchies of Britain. There's also Locke's ideas of natural rights, that rights are, that we have are given to us by virtue of the fact that we are human beings and they are given to us by God. Of course, that directly referred to in the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created, we've already done that, and that they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, which is echoed in the later in the Bill of Rights. We could perhaps talk about this at some stage, but the pursuit of happiness gets lost and replaced really with property. Property becomes the replacement for the pursuit of happiness as we go along. And a lot of scholars find that very interesting. And also Locke's understanding of the state of nature and social contract. So that's what a constitution really is. It's a contract amongst a group of people. After all, the preamble of our constitution is we the people. And this idea of social contract theory comes largely from Locke. He's not the first person to talk about it, but the way it was interpreted by our founders comes largely from Locke. And that's also reflected in the words of the Declaration of Independence, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. And of course, Americans experimented in these before. There were state constitutions. There's the Mayflower Compact, perhaps the first American understanding of the social contract. What is interesting, I think, about sort of Lockean liberalism and its effect on the American Revolution is it does differentiate the American Revolution from another event which was largely contemporaneous, which is the French Revolution, which is seen as much more radical. And one of this sort of interpretation, differentiating of the two revolutions, is captured, and I'm going to refer to some of the most influential literature about the American founding. And here's one of the examples. In Lewis Hart's The Liberal Tradition in America, which is about 70 years old, written in the mid-1950s. And Hart talks a lot about what I just talked about, but said, you know, the American Revolution was unique and different because it lacked the kind of deep energy and the violence of the French Revolution. It was a liberal revolution. It was rather than a radical one for two main reasons. One was that there was no feudalism in the European sense in the American colonies. And so no aristocracy, no titles of nobility, etc., etc. And also there was no religious dimension. Now, a lot of people say, well, the Puritans came here for religious reasons. They came because they believed they were being religiously persecuted. But that was in many ways an argument within Protestantism, that they were upset with the Church of England and the popery of the Church of England, of the Anglican religion. But it was still broadly a Protestant revolution, as opposed to, of course, the complete repudiation of the Catholic Church and Christianity in the French Revolution, which provided a tremendous amount of energy, particularly to many of the violent episodes. All right, the second sort of group of ideas I've loosely called English republicanism and institutions. And a lot of the thinking here comes from another influential work about the American Revolution. That's Bernard Bailyn's The Ideological Origins of the American Revolution, which is about 10 years after Hart's book. And Bailyn talks about a cast of characters, many of whom I don't think most Americans would know today, whose ideas and writings were very influential to our founders. People like James Harrington, Algernon Sidney, Bolingbroke, are a group of sort of British malcontents in the early 18th century. Harrington is 17th century and actually contemporaneous to the English Civil War, who basically saw a problem with the British system. And to boil it down, effectively said there just really aren't enough what we today might call checks and balances. This isn't an embrace of, this is very practical, and this is the very practical side of what our founders thought was important. The Lockean liberal side is visceral, it's about ideas, it's an expression of values and an idealism. Here's a sort of cynical side of them, a little bit more measured side of them, a little bit more strategic side of them, that you can have things like declarations of independence and constitutions, and you can declare we have natural rights, but unless you have a political system that can protect them, they're not going to be worth very much. And so they were very much, the founders were very influenced by these guys, a group really what loosely we could call Whigs. So people like Bolingbroke. Bolingbroke was very influential, was a real enemy of the first ever, what we tend to consider the first ever British Prime Minister. Walpole in the 1720s, because he said, you know, basically it's him and the king. And there's no check and balance. We need an opposition party. We need a real two-party system to check the concentration of power and corruption. And corruption is going to be important in the third set of ideas in a moment as well. Sidney actually was executed during the Stuart Restoration for his book, Discourses Concerning Government, in which he basically attacked monarchy and said, you know, all it does is centralize power. He was very much like Bolingbroke, saw the importance of competing political groups and competing political interests that could hold each other accountable and check each other's power. Harrington's book Oceana was very influential, got him a lot of trouble, of course, also with the monarchy during the English Civil War, in which he wrote about the importance of legislative supremacy, which was heresy at the time, of course, but it was a way of sort of saying legislatures are able to decentralize power more than executives are. It's also wrapped into this is the ideas of Edward Coke, Cook. It's written Coke, but it's pronounced Cook. Cook is sort of seen as the font of common law, which is very important in the American tradition, of course. And it is also something that greatly differentiates it from the French Revolution. And it, again, is a way of checking political power. The Baron de Montesquieu, who comes about 50 years before, is writing about 25, 30 years before our revolution, who wrote a lot about separation of powers, and our founders cite him considerably in the literature as an influence on them and the idea of separation of powers. And then thirdly, there's this idea of virtuous citizenry, which was seen as very important to the Republican tradition. Many of the founders, and if you read the Federalist Papers, for example, you see a lot of this, many of the founders harken back a lot to other republics in human history, particularly, of course, in the Roman Republic, particularly to the Greek city-states, but also to the Renaissance republics on the Italian peninsula, and also to a certain extent, you know, the Dutch Republic. And the argument was that these were republics that the United States was like, rather than, of course, an old world traditional monarchy, and that in order for them to be able to survive, they needed, and fortunately America had, a virtuous citizenry that was capable of protecting and advancing the republic. The works here that sort of are in this strain of thought include Pocock's A Machiavellian Moment, which came out in the early 70s, Gordon Wood's The Creation of the American Republic, which many of you may know, have heard of Gordon Wood, very famous American historian of the American founding. And this was the idea that Americans could have a republic and were fundamentally suited for it by basically their nature. So they were, as opposed to obviously many Britons, but also others on the old continent who were corrupted by modernity, luxury, self-indulgence, cosmopolitanism. Americans were hardworking, provincial, sturdy, wise in a sort of streetwise, commonsensical way rather than a sort of abstract and philosophical way, self-disciplined and uncorrupted, peculiarly suited for a Republican form of government by virtue of their temperament. And this, for those of you, I'm sure some of you have read Benjamin Franklin's autobiography. This comes out a lot in Franklin's autobiography, and his tremendous admiration for the merchants and the yeomen and the shopkeepers of America. Like, well, I guess we would call today the small business people, right, of America, as opposed to the sort of big commercial, the bankers of Europe and the aristocrats of Europe. He saw that Americans thought of themselves as sovereign individuals who were able to freely engage in commercial enterprise with one another. They generated social value through their behavior, like frugality, and through their relationships with each other, which they considered to be reciprocal. So those are sort of three senses of the idea. Now, I think together, these sort of have helped make us think about America as an exceptional nation. And they're clearly reflected in the Declaration of Independence. I made some direct references to that. And at the time of the founding, they were increasingly important because Britain became associated with their opposites. And Americans considered themselves to have different values and to embrace things that the British, everything that the British were not. So, you read the Declaration of Independence, of course, and most of it is set aside for grievances made against King George III. The first part we always read, and we know the famous lines in it that I've cited, I quoted earlier on, but most of the document is set aside as grievances against what George III has done and appeals to the British people and British Parliament about his corruption. They see Britain as an overly centralized authority, wallowed in material luxury, with a disregard for independent liberty and the rights of the individual. You can see how these ideas are generating the practical search for independence. Now, obviously, we're not celebrating the Constitution in 2026. And the Constitution is very interesting, and I don't have time to talk about it. I just mention it, but to make it different from, obviously, the Act of Independence and the founding itself. A lot of people, and I think I agree with them, see the Declaration of Independence as a sort of expression of these values. The Constitution is a lot more of a kind of political document that has to be, is a much more practical document because it has to actually establish the United States of America and its government. And so the Constitution doesn't express these values quite as neatly and as tidily and as cleanly, as clearly. And we know the Constitution as a series of important compromises that were made between various different interests at the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. The great compromise between the large and small states, largely over the composition of Congress. The three-fifths compromise between the northern and southern states over on how enslaved Americans should be counted with regards to taxation and representation in the House of Representatives. The idea that we need to balance the public opinion at the national level with the interests and the ideas and the needs of the states. The actual act of compromising with the Anti-Federalists in order to get the Constitution ratified, because the Constitution wasn't going to be worth much unless it was ratified by nine states. And agreeing to creating a Bill of Rights in order to win over enough support from Anti-Federalists to get the constitution ratified in 9 states. And in fact, in that ratification process, North Carolina wasn't particularly happy. We were the 12th of the 13 states to ratify. At that stage, of course, it was a fait accompli, because you only needed 9 states to ratify the Constitution for the United States of America to take effect under the rules of the Constitution. So the question in front of North Carolina then was, do we want in or out? We couldn't stop the country and the Constitution then, and of course we decided to ratify. Rhode Island, by the way, was the 13th of the original colonies, or original states to ratify, and Rhode Island didn't even send delegates to the Constitutional Convention because they were very suspicious of what was going to happen. I think, you know, looking at the difference between the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, one of the interesting evaluations of the importance of both of those documents, which are, of course, incredibly important in their own right, to the expression of the American founding, was made by President Lincoln at the Gettysburg Address. And obviously everybody knows the Gettysburg Address. I could read it to you here because it'd take me literally like 90 seconds, but I'm not going to. It's so short. But in it, I will read a couple of bits of it to you. Lincoln is clearly referring to the Declaration of Independence as capturing the true spirit of the United States rather than the Constitution. And of course, we know the context of this, right? The Civil War is not over, but it is at its height, and there's a tremendous struggle going on. And in talking about those soldiers, those Union soldiers, and their actions in Gettysburg, Lincoln says this in the first line to the Gettysburg Address, 47 years ago, that is 1776, not 1787, right? Our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. And then in the last line, we hear highly resolved that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people shall not perish from the earth. I think he constantly, and Lincoln himself towards the end of the Civil War, refers as a North Star, refers to the Declaration of Independence as his North Star rather than the Constitution. Which, of course, is fundamentally revised after the Civil War with the Civil War Amendments of 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment to transform the Constitution. And probably, if Lincoln had lived to see it all, he would say to bring it much more into line with the values of the Declaration of Independence. This is probably where I feel a little inadequate, but I will, since it's a charge of the committee, I will sort of, and instead of going on the portal, I can do it here. How do we in this state commemorate this great occasion? So I think one way might be to talk a little bit more about the state's pivotal role. I mentioned the Halifax Resolves and the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence stroke resolves. That would be something that would, I think, be a tremendous contribution. We could talk about commemorating some of the important battles. The battles of Kings Mountain and Cowpens actually occurred in South Carolina and the national battlefields there. But obviously, the environs in North Carolina, just north of the border of those, are important, as was Nathaniel Greene and Cornwallis's skirmishes through the state of North Carolina during the Southern Campaign. There are important political figures like Greene and military figures like Greene, who actually was not a North Carolinian, he is a Quaker from Rhode Island, I think. And then I think he retired to Georgia. Actually, I know that because they've got a big statue of him in Savannah. William Lenoir, who basically was important to the North Carolina part of the Southern Campaign. John Ash, and Ash and Lenoir are famous North Carolina names, of course. Although I think Asheville was named after John Ash's brother, not General Ash himself, if I remember rightly. I'm not sure about that. Important in the Southern Campaign. And then the founders, three of perhaps important founders in terms of signers of and signatories of the Declaration of Independence, like Davy, and Hugh Williamson. thinking about them a little bit, talking about them a little bit, investigating and a little bit about those important key individuals. And then a sort of emphasizing of those important values that I just talked about before. You know, we talk about liberty and equality. I think we don't really think about them as much as we should. We talk about them a lot, but maybe we should think about what they really mean. And then I think, especially in the context of the 2020s, given the polarized nature of politics these days and how divided Americans seem to be, I think Senator Alexander sort of hinted at this in his introductory remarks. This provides an opportunity for us, even for 10 minutes, you know, because the bickering and the polarization seems incessant, to sort of think a little bit about shared Americanness, which is sort of part of shared humanity, and the important values that the United States stands for in that respect. And a lot of that involves sort of ideas of civic virtue and responsibility and obligation. It also involves, I think, a respect for institutions and a respect for particularly such a respect for them that we want them to function properly because they are so important to the protection of these American ideals. Anyway, I believe, yeah, that's all I had. So thank you for indulging me.
Thank you, Professor Taylor. That was phenomenal. Thank you so much. And I certainly learned a lot, and I think that everybody here has as well. And I think you kind of get the idea now, perhaps, a little bit about what we were doing is setting the table. So to further talk a little about some issues or our history, the next speaker is North Carolina First in Freedom, and that's Dr. Troy Kickler. Who is co-editor and contributor to North Carolina's Revolutionary Founders 2019. He's a faculty at NC State University from 2007 to 2010 and 2014, and Liberty University since 2017. So, Dr. Kickler, I'm going to let you go ahead and have the floor.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. As been mentioned, my name is Troy Kickler. I'm the author of North Carolina's Revolutionary Founders, and in that, a retired professor from Barton College, Jeff Broadwater, and I try to expand the definition of a founder. And if you read that book, as former Senator Neely has, you can see there's a chapter on the Catawba. There's a chapter on John Chavis. There's a chapter on women in North Carolina. And then there are the usual suspects, like the signers of the Declaration of Independence. And as I mentioned earlier in my introductory remarks, I've been studying in some fashion in different organizations North Carolina history for 24 years now. So don't know everything about North Carolina history, of course, because I'm always learning, but I know a few things, but what I was going to talk today is North Carolina First and Freedom. You've probably seen a lot of license plates that say First and Freedom, the North Carolina license tags, and there's a reason for that. And so I want to tell you some of the reasons why the license plate says First and Freedom, and that's a slogan that North Carolina has. Now, again, a caveat here, this is going to be a cursory history. A cursory explanation of a nuanced and complicated history, but let's get started. North First and Freedom. How many of us have heard of, this is a rhetorical question, but how many of us have heard of the Edenton Tea Party, which occurred on October 25th, 26th? Anyway, it occurred late October, 1774. But the Edenton Tea Party is very important because it was the first organized political activity by women in what will become the United States of America. Now, there had always been individual actors in history. You can think of Joan of Arc. You can think of Mary Rawlinson, who was expelled from the Massachusetts Bay Colony. But this is the first time that, again, the first time women in an organized fashion stepped into the political sphere in what will become the United States of America. They signed a petition that was protesting the tea tax. And they thought, what better way to hurt the British economy, sorry, than to have a boycott on tea. And so that's what they did. And it was printed in a Virginia newspaper. It went, people in Great Britain heard about it in England. And Arthur Iredell, who was living in England at the time, wrote to his brother, James Iredell, one of the first U.S. Supreme Court justices, wrote to him, and essentially, not in these words, but essentially said, what is going on in Edenton, North Carolina? Has the world been turned upside down? And then Arthur Iredell to his brother James said, I wouldn't dare give these women darts, you know, because we don't know what they're going to do with, you know. So, but if you read the petition, they say in that petition they're following the laudable example of their husbands, and they're protesting this tax. They're protesting this tax for their prosperity. They were taking this action for their children, their grandchildren, and their descendants who they would never, ever meet. That's why they were doing that. And it was a bold action. Today, signing a petition, we don't think much about it. But this was unheard of, unprecedented at the time. Like sometimes my office is no longer downtown, but I'd be walking to get lunch, and people on Fayetteville Street would want me to sign a petition. And I, in my mind, I'm like, you know, I only got 30 minutes. I got to get back to the office, you know. Don't bother me. But this was a very bold move at the time. And I'm going to repeat some things that Professor Taylor has said, but some things need to be repeated. If you look at the state flag, there are two dates on it. One is May 20th, 1775. The other is April 12th, 1776. And those two dates are justification for North Carolina to say that it's first in freedom. So the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence, as was alluded to earlier, not alluded to, those mentioned earlier and explained, there's no proof. Let's just be candid. There's no proof that the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence occurred. There is proof that the Mecklenburg Resolves occurred on May 31st, 1775. But I have no reason to doubt that the spirit of Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence was around on May 20th. But it's just the point that if I was a lawyer and I'm going to court, I couldn't prove my case because I don't have a document to show for it. It's just me talking about it. It's hearsay. So, and but what's kind of cool about the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence, an 1819 individual, forget his name, remembered the Mecklenburg Declaration verbatim. And so you think, can somebody remember a document verbatim like 30 years after the fact? Maybe not, but they could know the gist of it. And then also think about this too. 1819, from 1815 to 1820 in United States history, was called the Era of Great Feelings. Why was it called that? Because the United States of America had defeated Great Britain in the War of 1812. So it was the Era of Great Feelings. The United States was no longer a fledgling nation. It was legit at this point. And so the remembrance of the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence occurred during this Era of Great Feelings. But we do know that the Mecklenburg Resolves occurred on May 31st, 1776, because we have a document to prove it. Now, Mecklenburg was the first, but they were not alone in this regard. You also have the Tryon Resolves, which now Representative Blackwell and Senator Alexander, Tryon County was the old county. It splintered into other different counties like Gaston, Alexander, and so forth. And then there's the Orange Resolves, which is another famous resolves. But the Mecklenburg resolves were first. So this was happening across what would become the state of North Carolina. There were battles that occurred here, and getting ahead of myself here, let's go to the second date on the flag, April 12th, 1776. There were delegates from North Carolina at the Continental Congress in Philadelphia, and people were thinking about independence. But the delegates from North Carolina who were there were saying, we don't have the authority to act on this. So they were writing to the provincial Congress, to what we would call the General Assembly, although the provincial Congress was sort of an independent action from what had happened before, because typically the royal governor would call the General Assembly or the House of Commons to order, and he wasn't doing that, so North Carolinians decided they would form their own provincial Congress. But the delegates in Philadelphia said, we don't have, essentially, this is a gist, we don't have the authority to act on this. So they were writing to the provincial Congress, to the delegates back in North Carolina. And at the fourth provincial Congress in Halifax, as Professor Taylor was saying, the provincial Congress empowered those delegates to cooperate with delegates from other colonies to work for independency. So that's the first time that a colony had done that. And during this time, too, you got to remember, communities were starting to declare their independence from Great Britain. We have what happened in Mecklenburg the year before. We have the Halifax Resolves empowering the delegates to declare independency. If you go to Edenton, North Carolina, and you go to St. Paul's Church, on the back, when you exit, you'll see a stone in the wall. And in June, I forget the exact date, but in June of 1776, the vestry of the church declared its independence from Great Britain. So these things are happening up and down the Atlantic seaboard. So what I tell when I teach about this topic to my class, I don't want to minimize the importance of the Declaration of Independence, because as was mentioned earlier, it's a very early, very important document. But if you think about it in this way, again, this stuff is happening in local communities in North Carolina and up and down the Atlantic seaboard. So if you think about it, in some ways, the Declaration of Independence is a recognition of what is already happening in the, up and down the Atlantic seaboard. So we have the Mecklenburg Declaration of Independence, or the Resolves, the Halifax Resolves. Those are two things, two very important things that justify North Carolina calling itself or having a slogan saying first and freedom. And I want to tell you about a couple important people, well, three important people during the time, and then I'll talk about what Professor Taylor mentioned too about the ratification conventions of North Carolina. Again, that's not the American Revolution, but there is definitely a link between, it's the founding. So you can lump those, the American Revolution and study of the Constitution, you can lump them into the study of the founding era. One is a man named Samuel Johnston. He was president of one of the conventions, the Constitutional Conventions, and at the time you didn't have the office of the President of the United States. But essentially, in some ways, one could argue that in a de facto way, he was the President of the United States, because he was President of the Continental Congress. And so he was very, very influential, and he was one of the first U.S. senators from North Carolina, once North Carolina became a state. The other is Governor Thomas Burke, the namesake of Burke County. If you, there's a reason why I'm mentioning him. So if you read the Articles of Confederation, Article 3 is the language of Thomas Burke. And now when the Constitutional Convention, people were wanting to revise Articles of Confederation or scrap it entirely and come up with a new document. The language, I encourage you to read Article 3 of the Articles of Confederation and then read the 10th Amendment and the Bill of Rights. Very similar language. So Thomas Burke had an influence, I would argue, on the 10th Amendment and the Bill of Rights. And again, I encourage you to read Article 3 of the Articles of Confederation and compare it with the 10th Amendment and the Bill of Rights. Another person I want to talk about is a man named James Iredell, namesake of Iredell County. He was one of the first justices on the U.S. Supreme Court. Wrote many, before he was a justice and during the Revolutionary era, he was a leading pamphleteer in the state. He wrote, we've all heard of like the Federalist Papers, which in a way was just an effort to get New York to ratify the Constitution, but James Iredell was writing these pamphlets at the same time the authors of the Federalist Papers were writing theirs. And James Iredell wrote under the pseudonym of Marcus. And so I think he would be a good person to remember as well. And on a related, yet maybe at the risk of going down a rabbit trail, as one of my eighth grade teacher would say a lot, if you look at the names of the counties in the western part of the state, they're named after influential people who were from the eastern part of the state. And it was a way to foster a sense of, there's still a sense of regionalism in North Carolina, but this is an age before TV, radio, the internet, and all that. This was an effort to try to foster a North Carolina identity. So just think of some of the names of the western counties. Caldwell, Iredell, Gaston, Burke, Swain, Macon, those, and there are more, but that was just an effort to foster a sense of North Carolina identity. And then the last thing I would like to talk about before I get to some recommendations that I have, the last thing is about North Carolina's role in the ratification of the Constitution and ensuring that there was a Bill of Rights added to the Constitution. Well, in 1787, the Constitution was drafted in Philadelphia, and it was submitted to the states to ratify, to approve. And as Professor Taylor mentioned, in Article 7 of the U.S. Constitution, all that was needed were 9 states to ratify the Constitution, and then the new union was formed. So it's submitted to the states to ratify. Well, North Carolina, and among others, had one big question. Why isn't there a Declaration of Rights in the U.S. Constitution? Every state constitution has a Declaration of Rights. It might precede the Constitution, it might be after the Constitution or mixed in, but every state constitution had a Declaration of Rights. Why doesn't this newly proposed national constitution have a Bill of Rights? So when the Constitution was submitted to the states to ratify, North Carolina in Hillsborough in 1788 decided we're not going to ratify it, but we're not going to reject it either. Because if you reject it, that means, you know, the opportunity is missed to join the new union. But they expressed their concerns so again, they neither rejected nor ratified the Constitution. But during this time, and if you want to read the ratification minutes, it's on Documenting the American South. And you can read the minutes there. And a colleague of mine has said, of course, he was born here in North Carolina, so maybe he's partial, but I think he's right. Those minutes which are documenting the American South, which is a UNC effort. He said they're some of the best minutes of the ratification debate. It's because typically the Federalists would hire transcribers, and then so they would hire them to transcribe the minutes, like a court reporter, you know, in a court or something. But then they would hand it over to the people who hired them to transcribe the minutes, and then the Federalists would edit them. And so you can see a more robust discussion between the Federalist and the Anti-Federalist in the North Carolina minutes, because the North Carolina Federalist had a lighter editorial hand. You can see the debate going on between the Federalist and Anti-Federalist. But North Carolina didn't reject nor ratify the Constitution at Hillsborough in 1788. But the new union was formed because nine quickly ratified the United States Constitution. Virginia, North Carolina, Rhode Island, and New York took their time in doing so. I'll just put it that way to make a long story short. But once North Carolinians were assured, so just think about that for a second. Trying to get a lot of history here in like a short amount of time, but just think about it. The new union was formed. North Carolina hadn't ratified the Constitution yet, which means North Carolina was out of the union for a year until they ratified the Constitution in Fayetteville in 1789. Now the Constitution's ratified, and if you look into the Constitution, there's North Carolina influences in that, and I'll just name two examples. One is the thought of Hugh Williamson, his ideas of the impeachment process are in the U.S. Constitution. It was his idea that senators serve 6 years, just a term of six years. Some folks, like Alexander Hamilton, wanted a senator to serve for life. Some do. But they have to be elected every 6 years. But it was Hugh Williamson's point that the terms. So there's a debate about that. And some of Hugh Williamson's critics say, I'll just use this little anecdote, say he spoke 70 times at the Constitutional Convention. If you look at Eliot's notes, you can count them. You know, you can fact check me. But spoke 70 times. And some of his critics said, no one said so much yet said so little. But if you look at the Constitution, his influence is there. And there are many more good stories about that. And briefly, I'll go into some suggestions that we might have. And I wish I had a photo to show you. There's a famous portrait of the signing of the Constitution, the delegates at the Philadelphia convention. Howard Chandler Christie was commissioned in 1937 to paint this image. 1939, it's hanged in the Capitol Halls in D.C. It's a famous portrait. And there's a desk, and behind the desk is George Washington with his hands behind his back, and he's leaning back like this. And there are three men at the front of the desk. One's bent down, signing it. The other has his foot up on the step, getting ready to be next. And then there's one on the other side looking at this. And that's the North Carolina delegation. That's William Blunt, Hugh Williamson, and Richard Dobbs Spaight. So that's it, and it hangs in the Capitol right now. Well, some of the ideas that I had, and these are just general ideas, that we can commemorate the American Revolution is you can have a lecture series. You can have a lecture series at various historic sites, which would be kind of cool, make it more meaningful if people actually see the site that you're talking about, and maybe you can get some living history actors there to make it more real. You could have a pamphlet series, whether that be in print or online. There can be historical markers or small monuments that would make sure that this the ideas of the North Carolinians are remembered. And I'm envisioning something, maybe not on the scale of Freedom Park across the street, but something to that effect. And this is an effort to get local communities interested in their history too, like maybe in Burke County, there can be just a lecture about Thomas Burke, or some type of marker, or online essay about Thomas Burke. You could have history tours where, again, I'm just thinking out loud here. I haven't really refined these thoughts, just brainstorming here. You could have history tours where people, whether it be charter buses or people just show up at certain places, and you can have lectures there or events. And if you don't have a tour of that nature, a brochure could be created where you could encourage people to visit certain sites. And then you can tell them why it's important. One can make a documentary. And nowadays, the attention span nowadays is shorter than it has been. So I'm thinking of something like a short documentary, like 10 minutes, something like that, about maybe particular, you could have a series of them about particular sites, or you could have one about the whole era. There could be teacher workshops. And then I think a focus we could have in all of these events, I think a focus would be like what I tried to do in the book that was published in 2019, is to expand the definition of founder. But in doing so, we're remembering that these diverse group of people participated in the American Revolution to preserve first principle. So I think that's just a few ideas that haven't been refined, but I hope that gets the ball rolling. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And those were excellent presentations and excellent thoughts, which leads me to think, as committee members, I do hope that you saw the recommendations that were made by Professor Taylor, and you heard the recommendations here made. You yourself, I will hope, will kind of be thinking in your own way of your own thoughts about what we as a committee might be doing and how we might, you know, your own recommendations, I guess. So keep that in mind, because that will serve as a point of discussion for us at some point in time. And so our next presentation is Spilling the Tea, How to Properly Celebrate America's Independence. This is Kelly Northstein, Associate Vice President for Student Life of Campbell University. So thank you.
So I want to talk a little bit about who I am as a person and the perspective that I bring that maybe will explain some of the ideas or different things that I'm going to present or talk about. So first off, I do work at Campbell University. I've been there about 9 years. I am the Associate Vice President, a glorified Dean of Students, if you will. So I am a lawyer by trade, but I do compliance for the university, code of conduct kind of issues. I write a lot of policies. But then because I am in student life, I do a lot of events and programming and engaging with our students. And I'm constantly having to take, even this earlier this week, I had to take a code of conduct violation that we had, and it was the second time we had a student. So I could just sanction the student, but it was like, what's the educational outcome that we're trying to achieve here, right? Everything we do is around education. So within my job in that role, I do approach, we can have certain things we do, but what's the educational piece? And then what's the engagement piece? So again, with students, I'm always thinking of how do we engage? We don't just talk to them, we don't just publish things, but how do we get their attention and then get them to engage back with us? So that's kind of the first piece is I am an educator. I do think about learning outcomes, but then I also think about engagement. I'm also a woman, so I'm going to give you some ideas about things I think that a way we can showcase and talk about who are the women in history that maybe we have not highlighted previously. I am a mother, I have three sons. My house is crazy. And so I'm constantly looking for things to do with my children. A lot of times I'll clean our house Saturday morning, and then I don't want them back in my house. So like this past Saturday, we were at the Durham Life and Science Museum from 9 till 4 p.m., and my kids, like, they had a ball, right? So I'm constantly looking for things to take them, places to go. We went to Charlotte 2 weekends ago, and there were tons of street art, and they have this light festival going on right now. I think it's called Charlotte Shout. And so we spent several days there. So things that we can do as a family that I can engage with my children, but that are educational, right? That's something I can take them to. So I'm bringing that perspective as well. And then the other thing is I am a young professional, or I like to think I'm young. And so I, too, myself, am looking for things that are fun, right? I want to go to an event out. I get tired of just going to dinner with my husband. I want to do a date night that's something that, okay, no, I'm not like that, just the dinner aspect, right? So I want to do something that's engagement or different. So those are kind of the things when Dr. Kickler asked me that I was like, okay, those are the things that I want to do and to engage with history or with our state. So I have kind of three principles, if you will, when you're thinking of events or thinking about programming. One, do not be afraid of technology and social media. You're going to have to engage. So if you think about 50 years ago, when we celebrated America, Instagram, Facebook, those are things that were not created that are very much a part of our world today. And so whether it's posts or it's stories or it's even Dr. Kickler mentioned like a 10-minute documentary, there's ways even on Instagram that you show or highlight 90 seconds that you get someone's attention and then they want to engage in the whole thing. So you have to think about that. Think about QR codes. So if you are doing a lecture series and it's at a history site, how is the person going to engage that maybe is not there for the tour? Or you're with me, you know, I have a 2-year-old who's running around. I'm not going to sit here and listen to a lecture. I'm in the background. But is there a QR code I can scan and I can read while I'm watching this child? Or it pulls up a video so I can passively engage and learn about the country and the state's history, right? So that'd be my first thing is, like, as you're thinking about events, programs, how are you incorporating technology? And think of passive. So what are those QR codes, Instagram? Those pieces are things that we can do that it's not always just going to an event or doing something. The second piece is having things that are interactive, not just passive, though. So I love Dr. Kickler's idea of, like, you can encourage people to go to historic sites, but is there a speaker? Are they in a costume? Because that's cool. But things like that, that it's interactive and it's different. Some of the ideas I'm going to present are going to be very interactive because, again, that's how I'm approaching. I'm looking for something that's fun. It's interesting to take my family to. And then finally, it has to be what I call experimental. There has to be an experience element with it. My generation and everyone underneath me, we want experiences. A lot of times people are looking for that Instagrammable moment. So people will pick a restaurant because it's pretty and they can take a picture in it. I know that sounds crazy, but it's real. So as you think about things, what is the presentation? What is the experience? And what is that person, especially if you want to pull in a younger generation, what is the moment or a thing that they can take a photo with or go to, right? And so is it something where there's pretty street art? Even when I parked and I was walking in, there's some really pretty like paintings and stuff on the sidewalk on this side. And so maybe it's something like that. Are there things that you can do, sidewalk art, or things where someone wants to stop and take a photo, and then they scan the QR code, having no idea what they're taking a photo of, and then now they learn something and engage. And then maybe it takes them to the website. And so then they want to figure out, where is all the other history or the element? This was really cool. I want to experience this. So I think those are kind of three things to think about. So kind of just a couple of ideas. We recently, as a family, went to Williamsburg and loved it. My children didn't really know a whole lot about the American founding. Actually, this is a quick story. They had a musket showing, so they shot off a rifle. My boys loved that. And they were like, any questions? And my 5-year-old raises his hand and he says, was the American Revolutionary War before or after the Vietnam War? We're like, okay, so we clearly need to talk about this when we get back in the car. But they love that, and they, to this day, we actually end up buying them a whole bunch of books, and that's what they want to read right now. And not because, like, oh, there were people in costumes. they still talk about like the musket, how they showed them and they loaded it up and they shot it. People were in costumes. There was pottery and things they could touch and look at. And if you have young children, you've been around them, that's what they want. They want things they can hold or touch. And you can tell them all day long, but until they can physically see something, it just like almost opens up their mind, or there's this whole other world or thing out there. So I don't know what that would look or feel like, but to bring a street festival here that's 1 or 2 days, or in Charlotte or somewhere else, where it's almost like an old town like Williamsburg, where you have vendors on the street of, maybe there is music and it is like old pipes and drums or different fanzines like that. There are people in costume. There's food. You get to eat a meal like maybe that people did in the 1700s. There's some kind of crafts. And I do know there's so many, especially if you get into the rural areas of North Carolina, where people still practice certain like forgotten trades or aspects of art, if you will, highlighting, bringing people back to show what were things that were done there, so people can interact, people can buy things, but it's a whole experience. And to even take it that extra notch of even having like horse and carriage rides like they do in Williamsburg, like things like that, that would be really cool. And maybe the people that are doing them are in costume and are even able to talk about what it would have been like there, right? So thinking about that, if you've ever been to Williamsburg, they do little one-act plays. So I think about the Bluegrass Festival that Raleigh has showcased for years, and in all the different side streets, there's like a different stage and there's different things going on beyond just Fayetteville Street. So thinking like big picture of, you have certain things, but there can be their side things of, maybe there are one-act plays, maybe there are concerts, but it's a festival over multiple days to just really highlight and allow someone, if they want that immersive experience, that they could do so. And you have to have fireworks, right? So I would be remiss if I didn't mention that. I, thinking of a fun, really cool Instagram, you grab the younger generation, I think some kind of cocktail party in the History Museum, like party like it's 1776. I'm going. The cocktails are fun names, you know, whether it's Red Coat or whatever. I'm telling you, younger people, 40 below, like, they would eat that up and love that. And then the history part is, you have different exhibits that they can walk around in, right? It's just not like a cocktail party. Maybe there's a documentary that we're showing in the theater. There's something highlighting the North Carolina people in the museum about what was their role in our history, right, to get to the founding. But things like that that are catchy, that someone stops and says, that's fun, that's different. Like, I want to go to that. I want to be a part of that. And then that's where you sneak in the educational pieces, right? I think, too, something around, you have to highlight the women. So if it's a lecture series, or it's pamphlets, or it's even looking at different places across our state that we stop or we highlight, but like, who are the women? A lot of times behind the scenes, but we know their names, right? Betsy Ross or Martha Washington, but even in our state, who are the women that really... that were a part of our history. You mentioned the Eatonton women. And so whatever that looks like, making sure we do something to really highlight the women and their involvement in history. I think some kind of fun tea party. I would be remiss, my husband was like, just so we're clear, the Boston Tea Party isn't really, and I was like, but it's a part of it. I was trying to tell him this morning. But I think it's, you have to think big picture history in the gateway. So is that, you know, you're inviting women and their daughters, like, let's have a tea party. Let's talk about the founding. Again, what are those engagement? What's that experience? Something that I can go to and do. I recently passed, actually in September at Campbell University. So when you receive federal funding at a institution, you have to acknowledge Constitution Day. So I actually helped that with my institution. And so this past September, we did a panel of students, community members, and professors where we talked about civility and something that we feel like has been lost in our culture. And in some ways, social media has made that worse, right? People don't want to engage with the other face-to-face, but they say all kinds of mean things online. So when you're thinking about panels and lectures, yes, you can do things very strictly around history or our founding, but I loved what Dr. Taylor wrote, and I put down like civic virtue. Can you have a panel or a discussion where it's around virtues or concepts? It's not just around the history. I think it'd be interesting where you can bring in some historians and professors, but bring in a student. Get Campbell would love to host something, or another college, and to say, can you bring students? And so those young, fresh voices to interact to say, What did this mean, you know, as part of our founding, but how does this play out now? And is this lost in American culture, and how do we get it back? So I think that you can have conversations around concepts or things that the founding is founded on, but then bring it kind of like, where is this being lived out now? I think those are kind of my points and some of my ideas that I had. Thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you so much, Kelly, and what enthusiasm you bring and all the speakers that have talked. I was just sitting here. I thought this was really good because what we started was with a kind of emphasis and topics and ideals. And then we kind of continued that with Dr. Kickler's. And then he sort of transitioned to some events. And then you brought out the kind of experiential. So if you look at what I think we are tasked with, or what I think we should be tasked with, it's kind of coming up with the areas of emphasis, but also, okay, how do we play those out? How do we relate those? How do we promote those kinds of things? So that's sort of what we, I think, should be doing. And before we, and I want to give a little bit of discussion. I don't want to keep us too long today, but I do want to give a little bit of discussion in terms of any things and ideas, and it'll be almost like speed dating where you tell us real quickly what you want us to know in terms of how we will proceed. I do want to, having heard the various presentations, if there is anyone in the public that would like to speak for 2 minutes or so, you're certainly welcome to do that, and you may if you wish. Anybody want to do that?
Chairman, I see folks here from Cultural Resources. They have an extraordinary educational program in this area of the revolution, and I'd love to hear what they have to say.
I think, Deans, you're it. If you'll just give your name and your position, the chair will allow a little bit longer than 2 minutes if you'd like, because you have, but you take us, you know, if give us a good rundown.
Our agency is your state agency partner for this work. We really are excited that you all are convening today and to have you as a partner in our commemoration of the 250th. We actually just have formally kicked off our commemoration work this past weekend in Halifax. As Representative Blackwell, Chairman Blackwell said, he and I are both Halifax County natives and very proud, as you all heard today, of the role that Halifax played in the 250th and the founding of our one of many important stories in North Carolina. Our agency covers historic sites, museums, several of the entities that we've already talked about today. Revolutionary War battlefields, a few of which you've not covered yet. The Battle of Morris Creek is a National Park Service site, but House in the Horseshoe in Moore County is a state historic site. It's a site of a revolutionary battle. Sarah Koontz, our state archivist, is with me as well this morning. She's leading from the staff perspective our department's efforts for the 250th, and I think we are looking forward to spending time with you at a future meeting to go into more detail about all of the work we've already been doing and some of the things we have in our plans, and really look forward to merging those with the feedback that you are already getting and I'm sure we'll be getting in the coming weeks. And so mostly I'm just here today to say we're looking forward to the partnership, appreciate your enthusiasm, and certainly want you all to think of us as a resource for your work, and we'll be doing the same.
Thank you, Deans. Representative Blackwell.
Just a quick comment. We had talked to the department about possibly presenting today, but they were already engaged fully with the Halifax celebration, and I think we probably gave them too short a notice, but I anticipate, hopefully, that at our next meeting we can have them do what Dean just said.
Yes.
And give us a fuller presentation of their thinking.
Thank you, Chairman Blackwell. He's exactly right. And we did have a meeting, the chairman and I had a meeting with Representative for Cultural Resources earlier on to get an idea of the kinds of things they're already well into planning and so forth. So we will hope to be a partner in a lot of those kinds of things. Let's see. At this point in time, I will open it up for members of our committee. You may have heard something, you may have thought of something, you may have something you'd like to say that you think will be important for our committee as we move forward. Again, I'm thinking, and maybe I'm there's another topic that I'm, but I'm thinking in terms of the topic, the you know, the sort of the emphasis, areas of emphases, and then also the experiential kinds of things that, you know, how do we translate these topics, these emphases, and how do we get them across, and how do we celebrate them in our public. So I'm going to kind of leave it up, and if you'd like to be recognized, just raise your hand, and then we'll, you know, we'll take your comments now from the members of the committee. And if you don't have anything to say now, we will certainly ask for your comments through email, but now's your chance.
Mr. Chairman, how is the committee going to solicit public comments and ideas?
Primarily, I think at this point in time, through the portal, but we're open to other suggestions of how we might receive those kinds of things. But right now, we have the portal that I think Henry has said is open,
coming today.
So soon we will have that portal up in it. But yes, a very good idea, a very good comment.
Kind of, go ahead. Kind of piggybacking off of that,
at least in my experience with city politics, trying to just say that there's a portal out here doesn't necessarily get a lot of feedback. So something that I think that we should really focus on is figuring out what stakeholders that we would like to have input from. So like, for example, one of the things that I thought of during the presentation was HBCUs, especially as it relates to Black community and the founding for their community. And so affirmatively reaching out to different stakeholders to get their feedback through the portal.
Good idea. Okay. And if and I will say, anytime you would like to amplify the comments, you know, later, to please send them, you know, do that. Okay.
I don't know whether the staff or maybe Henry can tell me, do all the members of the committee have the email addresses of everybody else on the committee and the staff and so forth?
I am not sure they do, but
I was just going to suggest, to follow up on what Mr. Lukey said, that we ought to be sure everybody has that contact information so that you could share, you know, the stakeholder, if you will, that you mentioned. Someone else may think of a different stakeholder, and that would be a way of us sharing that information that may come to mind outside the actual meeting.
I wonder if we could ask cultural resources to give us the names of museums, historical associations, societies, folks who are interested in things like this that might be worthwhile to solicit.
Deans, I think that you could probably share that with us, and we'll use those to help get the word out about the portal and other things too. Good idea, and good idea, Representative Neely. What are the suggestions, topics, areas of emphasis, or things that we need to be doing? All right. Well, as I said, we will we're going to take the comments and so forth that we've got here today, and Chairman and I will discuss those, and then we're going to continue to plan our meetings. Let's see, what else do I need to cover? Representative Blackwell, anything else?
Well, maybe briefly just a comment on future meetings. My sense is that we need not to let grass grow under our feet, but we need to get into this. The legislature begins meeting for its short session on April the 24th. So we are then competing for space here in Raleigh, at least, for having a meeting. There's a tentative suggestion that I've been given, Senator, from staff that we might could meet on a Friday in May. Is that something that would be possible for the members of the committee, you can let us know by email, tell us later. But just in case,
could do a doodle poll or something of that nature.
And, of course, I haven't discussed that with Senator Alexander because I just got that. We had asked the legislative folks about, well, where could we meet and when, and that was their suggestion. So we may have to work on figuring that out, but maybe this is the way to put it. If there are times or days that you know are really just going to be difficult for you, if you'd let us know, and we can keep that in mind. And as we think about an alternative, I suppose one option could be that we could meet off-site, not in the legislative building itself, here in Raleigh or elsewhere.
There's also been some talk about, well, we could have our meetings in a remote place as well, some historic place somewhere across the state. Again, part of what we're doing here is also part of the celebration. And the presentations that you've heard today here, I think, are magnificent and should be, you know, a lot of people should hear this stuff. It's a really, really good what y'all brought up. I'm just so proud of and thankful for what you did. Dr. Kickler.
Yeah, I follow up with what Representative Blackwell said. I think it's important that the committee keeps momentum and that we meet because things will start to accelerate here shortly. And we don't have to wait till July 4th, 2026.
That's right.
Because there are antecedents to the American Revolution. Some of them I mentioned in my little talk, like the Edenton Tea Party, and as Dean said about the Battle of Morris Creek Bridge, you know, the Halifax Resolves, the MECDEC. So in sum, I just think it's important that we meet sooner than later so we can keep momentum because at the risk of, well, repeating myself, things will accelerate and early May might not be good for me, but I think this is important work that what we're doing, and I'll rearrange my schedule.
Very good. Good point. Mr. Lukey.
I would like to emphasize kind of the going maybe remote offsite to different historical sites around the state. If one of the key parts of this committee is to bring awareness and excitement surrounding this, it doesn't necessarily help us to always be in a conference room in Raleigh, but like go to New Bern or go out to Greensboro or somewhere in order, and then put it in the local newspaper in order to emphasize what we're doing.
Or McGuire Woods could have us over to Mecklenburg.
Sure.
I think that's an excellent point. Very well taken, and yes, and Dr. Kickler, your point about, I mean, it seems like 2 years is a long way away, but it's not. 2026 is going to be here soon, and as you mentioned, there were things leading up to the revolution and the Declaration of Independence that, you know, those dates are fast approaching. So, but it doesn't mean that we can't just go ahead and jump right in, and that's what we hope to do. So, what else? Yes, Chairman Black.
If I was listening closely enough, and I may have got this wrong, the Tea Party in Edenton was in October of 1774.
Yes.
That's 250th year this year.
Yeah.
So, and then in 75 is the Declaration or the Resolves, depending on which route you want to go. But it seems to me, and this may be a part of the departments and what they're going to tell us about as well, but we also might want to put together a timeline of events leading up to the actual July 4, 1776, and maybe some of the events afterwards that sort of, in effect, consummated what was set out in the Declaration. I thought that Kelly had a lot of great ideas, and Dr. Kickler had some suggestions and recommendations. I think maybe we didn't hear them, but maybe we'll get them or have gotten them from Dr. Taylor. I was making some notes as they spoke, thinking, hey, you know, this might work for that idea. So I would encourage people who heard things that resonated with them to, again, share those things so we get them out on the table and can maybe talk about how we put all this together so that it becomes an organized effort rather than just a lot of great ideas that are all not exactly connected.
Yes, very good. Yes, Jason.
This may just, just adding to the pile, but I think it's going to be very important that we do start to look at the timeline of what we want to have associated with, because a lot of the historical sites are already working on that. Like for us, we are already starting to plan the celebration of the 250th of the MECDEC at Alexander's house.
Very good.
So there's probably a whole list of different sites that are already planning for the 250th anniversaries that it'll probably be very important for us to know what's already out there and how to build around it.
Me again? And you're telling us that also, and me thinking of some of the things that have already been said. If you guys are going to go to the trouble of organizing a production there in Mecklenburg, I would encourage you, if you haven't already, to think, well, how about taking that show on the road? The story of the Mecklenburg Declaration Resolves is something that could be shared in other parts of the state, especially if you've already got the program together or portions of it that would travel well, and it can become a documentary and all these various things.
Yeah, well, one of the things we'd actually talked about doing, and I've been wanting to do for years, I don't know if we can actually pull it off, is do a debate between the big resolves, which one was the most important, and have just a full-on, just like the resolve, fight. Between the Tryon Resolve, the Orangeburg Resolve, the Halifax Resolve, and the Declaration of Independence from Mecklenburg County, and have this kind of discussion that could be a fun, engaging, but as you said, I've never thought about putting it on the road, but something that could be done as a traveling activity at each one of those sites.
Very good. What are the things that Henry tells me that the public portal is open?
It's on
the main website for the legislature,
yes, sir.
The General Assembly, and we are going to send that link to our members of our committee. And what I would ask is that you as well share that with your constituent groups, because you will be a large part of us helping to get the word out, as well as the other things that were mentioned. But, you have folks that in your orbit that can contribute and can give us ideas, and we really appreciate that. Why don't we send it to the speakers as well, so that if you would do us the favor of doing the same thing, we would appreciate that. What other things have I missed? We will try to get out here fairly quickly, but what other things? This has been very good, and I hope that we will all come away stirred from hearing the words that we have heard, and I think it stirs something within us, and it certainly has with me, and I think that we need to be reminded about these things and how important this is to the formation of who we are as a country and where we're going. I'm going to ask our co-chairman one more time, any other comments before we...
One final comment, just FYI. In the process of lining up the presenters for today, we ran into a glitch, but apart from the folks at the department presenting hopefully next time, we also have a lady who is with the Frederick Douglass Society that is going to come, and I think that'll add some additional perspective to what we want to talk about.
Okay. All right. Yes, Dr. Kickler.
Anyway, quickly, and we also talked to some a lady who's on the National 250th, and she's willing.
Oh yeah,
to speak.
Yes, because there's a national equivalent to what we're doing here, so we certainly want to tie in with what they're doing. Yeah, we may say. All right. Well, this has been really good. I appreciate the enthusiasm that each of you has brought to the table today. Thank you for the staff and for those who have been listening in through the whatever it is we put broadcasts over our streaming. I'm a real high tech, you can tell, because this is my calendar right here. But anyway, but thank you again. And if there being no other business, we'll stand adjourned.
and stop the recording briefly, but I'm going to keep it going for a minute to see what the lay of the land looks like here in Raleigh. Being in Rutherford County, we have a lot of really fascinating American Revolutionary War sites, and I have a personal interest in American history and early American history. So this is a very fascinating committee, and we will see how things shake out. They did just announce this public portal, which really is only a request for comments web form, and I'll share that in a moment. Just a reminder, I am recording this too for archival purposes because the North Carolina General Assembly typically does not archive their live streams of their meetings in a meaningful way. So you have to physically watch it live in order to have an understanding of what exactly was said. There are certain rare circumstances where that's different, but they just don't do it as part of the rules. Right now on NCLEG.gov, you'll see a request for comment to what they discussed, this quote portal. It's really just a web form, request for comments, America's Semiquincentennial Committee. That's a mouthful, I know, of 250th birthday anniversary to celebrate the founding of the United States. It states, do you have suggestions on how the state might best commemorate the 250th anniversary of the Revolutionary War? So you can complete this form if you have suggestions. I would highly suggest that you also send yourself, before you hit submit, what I usually do is I click print and then I do print to PDF. So I have a record of what was sent. I don't know when you complete this form if you get a copy of what you send. And then you may also, in addition to this, what typically as a journalist and what I know a lot of more Raleigh area journalists do is occasionally they will ask lawmakers for they'll file public records requests for emails. And I don't know if there is a meaningful way to file. Basically, my thought is how many people at the end of this could journalists or really anyone's by law could do this, file public records requests to see how many people actually request, use this quote portal for information. So at the end of this, I won't give a number because I can't predict the future, but it'll be interesting to see how many people actually use this portal. So what I was saying is another suggestion is you, of course, could email the two co-chairs in addition to using this portal. I think that would give everyone a better sense of what is to come. And that way you have an email record of what you are sending. Of course, is when you ever you send lawmakers anything, you are more than welcome to CC me, copsincongress@gmail.com, and but definitely keep a record for yourself, and that's a good best practice in everything that we do, especially with online. I don't anticipate that anything very controversial will come of this committee, but who knows as things progress and certainly as the 2024 election unfolds. There's a lot of very interesting things in the works as they discussed. I think there's a lot of stakeholder groups that are sort of siloed and don't really talk to each other. Again, being in Rutherford County, I actually live near a few former forts, and there's commemorative markers all over the place for the Overmountain Victory Trail that goes on 64, aka Chimney Rock Road, where the Overmountain Victory men rode for the Battle of Cowpens, which was certainly an American victory, very quick, very interesting American victory. Again, please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com. I really appreciate your support in helping me shine a light on police and policy issues in North Carolina and beyond. Thanks for watching. See you next time.